Welcome to Letter and Spirit, our continuing conversation about Christian worship and the Word of God. I'm Mike Aquilina, and I welcome you to this conversation that we are having with Dr. Scott Hahn. Scott, welcome back.
Great to be with you, Mike.
Scott is professor of scripture and theology at Franciscan University of Steubenville. That's a mouthful.
Indeed.
And he's author of many books, including this one, Letter and Spirit, From Written Text to Living Word in the Liturgy. And that's the book we're discussing in this series. And today, Scott, we're going to come to the idea of authority. Now, you've made clear in past shows that our Lord established an office of authority in the church. He established the church with a certain authority structure, in part that it inherited from Israel. But in your book, you emphasize that that office is a liturgical office.
That's right, because ultimately, we want to get away from the notion that authority is just reducible to law, that hierarchy is nothing but imposing the will of the lawgiver upon these poor subjects.
What I say goes.
That's right. Liturgy is what reminds us that ultimately authority is about life. God is the author of life, and that's why he has authority over our lives. And so we have to understand law as something subordinate to the liturgy. Just as the tablets of stone, the Ten Commandments, were stored in the Ark of the Covenant, so we have to understand that God's commandments are stored inside the liturgy. The doctrines of the church are all found in their integrity and purity in the church's liturgical worship, bound up, as it were, sealed by the seven sacraments.
Now, then in the Old Covenant, you're talking about the Old Testament there, in the Old Covenant, was the teaching office in Israel a liturgical office?
It was. When you look at the people who were responsible for exercising authority, as Jesus says in Matthew 23, verses 2 and 3, the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. So that word cathedra, where we get the word cathedral, or the Pope speaking ex cathedra, the seat is the seat of Moses. Moses was not only the giver of the law, but the giver of the liturgy.
Okay.
In fact, most of what Moses gave to Israel was liturgical, much more than it was legal. And so there in Jerusalem, where the temple was, where the worship was celebrated, you have the officials given the responsibility for interpreting the law so that people might be able to come up clean and holy to celebrate the liturgy. Law keeping is not an end in itself. Ultimately, it comes to liturgy, which is life-giving.
Okay.
And this is what was done in the Old Testament, and it's done even more divinely in the New.
The law is what makes sure that we're ready for
That's
the
right.
liturgy.
Exactly. And so the law is order to the liturgy. You keep commandments so that you can enjoy communion. If you break commandments, you're kept out of communion until the moral healing that comes through forgiveness takes place and takes hold of your life. Ultimately, law is ordered to self-control, but self-control is ordered to self-giving, to self-sacrifice, to love.
Now, this is all Old Covenant we're talking about here. Is it something that became outmoded with the New Covenant?
No, it sure didn't. You know, we had in the Old Covenant the calendar, the liturgy, the festivals, the temple, the sacrifices, the priesthood, and all of that is continued and yet at the same time transformed. There's a transposition, a change of position from earth to heaven, from the merely human to the now divine and human. And so the sacraments of the New Law convey power through human ministers, but power that is ultimately divine, life that is ultimately heavenly life.
And do we find those offices of authority that are liturgical offices, do we find it in the infant church? Is it there in the Acts of the Apostles? Is it there in the Epistles?
It's there in the Acts of the Apostles from the get-go.
No.
In chapter 1, when Peter is addressing the body of the 11 now, since Judas has hung himself and is dead, he quotes the Psalms 69 and 118, and he refers to how Judas's death left his habitation desolate, but let his office another man take. And the word for office there in the Greek is episcope, where we get the word episcopal, episcopacy, the bishop. The King James Version actually translates that, let his bishopric another man take. So you have episcopal succession, just assumed categorically as a matter-of-fact sort of thing. Peter isn't announcing something novel. He isn't debating something. He's just telling them, we've got to get on with business. We've got to replace Judas. We've got to find a successor for his bishopric.
So this is assumed rather than asserted.
That's right. And the laying on of hands was the way in which this succession was maintained in the Old Testament, and so likewise in the new, the laying on of hands for the successors of the apostles, but likewise for the deacons as well.
Sacramental, liturgical, ritual.
Exactly. And so the word never comes in an abstract or in a vacuum. It's never merely conceptual or verbal. It always is covenantal, and so it's always liturgical and sacramental. This is what makes us more than just believers. It's what makes us a family of believers who are bonded not just by a set of common doctrines, but ultimately by one faith. We're free to explore the faith, and we do that in theology. But the faith comes before theologizing about the mysteries of faith. That's why we say when an infant is baptized, that infant has received the faith. Just as when an infant is born into a natural human family, that infant has the life of the parents. It's still seminally present. It isn't something that has nurtured and matured as much as, say, in an adolescent sibling that infant might have. But in effect, when we grow up, we're simply becoming what we were at birth. So when we grow up in our understanding of doctrine, we really simply reflect more and more upon the faith that was given once for all to us in the sacrament of baptism. You know, and this is something that we have to really grasp. I must say, as a tangent for a moment, that one of the most liberating discoveries in becoming a Catholic more than two decades ago was getting away from all the theological wrangling. Because in the Protestant world, your theology defined your church. Ultimately, your faith was defined either in terms of Luther's theology, if you were Lutheran, or Wesley's theology, if you were Wesleyan or Methodist, or Calvin's, if you were Presbyterian. But in the Catholic Church, you have different theologies. You have Augustinian, Thomistic, Bonaventurian, but you never confuse these theologies with the faith that was shared by Thomas Aquinas, Bonaventure, Augustine, and all the rest. The faith is something that is divine. It is something that is a unity. It's something that an infant can possess just as human life is given to a child at birth. So likewise, in the new birth of baptism, the faith in its integrity, the faith in its entirety is imparted by the magisterium.
This family idea is powerful because then we see the liturgy as bringing us together in a family meal.
That's
presided
right.
Over by a father. The bishop is a father, and he delegates that fatherhood to the priest.
If we move away from the legalistic view of hierarchy and authority to the liturgical view and see authority and hierarchy as life-giving, we rediscover the essential meaning of authority in the early church because it was a family hierarchy.
Yes.
Dionysius is the one who actually coined the term hierarchy. And for him, hierarchia literally means a sacred order, but he applies it to the relationship between the angels and the Trinity. And when he describes the celestial hierarchy, he describes the nine choirs of angels, and at the very top you have the seraphim and the cherubim, and at the very bottom you have the archangels and the angels. But you don't have the seraphim possessing 90%, then the cherubim 80%. There isn't something diminishing or decreasing as you go down. God the Father gives everything to the Son, and the Holy Spirit delivers all of it to the highest choirs in the hierarchy, so that the lowest archangels and angels get everything that the highest seraphim and cherubim get. And likewise, in the ecclesiastical hierarchy, that is, the church's sacred order, you have the bishops, and you have the priests, and the deacons, and the subdeacons, and the acolytes, and all of these offices. And down to the lowest layperson, the bishop gets all of God, and through the Holy Eucharist, so does the lowest layperson.
It's a hierarchy of service, really.
Exactly. In the family, you have this service being rendered through sacrifice. As a father, I'm a breadwinner. I'm the author of their life in an instrumental way, so I have authority, but I also sacrifice to nurture and sustain that life.
That's why that the Pope is the servant of the servants of God.
That title is the Pope's favorite title because it captures the essential meaning of his ministry. That's why we call him Holy Father. He isn't like a father. There's a sense in which he's even more of a father than I am. So is the presbyter, the parish priest. I mean, I win natural bread for my family as a breadwinner. They gain the bread of life, the supernatural bread of the Eucharist. And so we have this family vision captured and lived out in the liturgy. And so suddenly authority moves away from something legalistic and it becomes life-giving. Hierarchy is not an oppressive administration or bureaucracy. It's the means by which God the Father is fathering his family through the angels who are present in the liturgy, through the saints who are like our older brothers and sisters, but through the bishops and the priests and the deacons. They are there to serve us, and they serve us up a heavenly banquet that raises us up all the way to heaven so that we can become saints ourselves.